Okay, so welcome to 102, and I think this is going to be the last portion of thermodynamics module. All right, so that means once we complete this handout materials, then that we are heading to the first exam, all right? And that will be a lot of fun, I guess. Okay, so maybe just after today's lecture. Once we're done with the lecture and everything, then I'm just gonna ask you maybe just a rough idea of when would you like to have your first exam, okay? And I already asked the section one, and they said that they prefer to be on Saturday, I think. All right, so that was the idea. But anyway, so I was planning, I was just probably just asking you guys sort of like just give me a rough estimates and all this stuff, and then I will put a poll in our Google Classroom for you to vote. All right, and then we might have a couple of votes. I mean, we might have the first round voting, and then see if there are like a couple choices that's still left there to be decided, and then we might be able to do the second poll just to sort of like condense everything down into a single date that everyone seems to agree on. But anyway, so you will have many choices to pick in the poll and see the majority vote what direction or which date or end time that you would like to have. Sounds like a good plan. All right. So once we have the first exam done, usually we can repeat that pattern for the rest of the exams, the other two exams. So that shouldn't be a problem. Just the first time taking the exam, it seems to be, we need a little bit of arrangements and everything, so that should be, take a little bit of time, first time doing things, but that should be fine. All right, just want to make sure that you guys understand the logic. It's not a logic, actually. The plan that we planned at the first day that we met. All right, so once again, just to remind you that we're going to have three exams, so there will be three exams, okay? And each exam will worth 35 points, okay? So that means you're gonna have a total of 105 points to collect from these three exams, all right? And you will have assignments, and that will worth 10 points. So the total that you're going to get out of this is going to be 115, all right? And we are going to take your raw, I mean, well, I'm not sure if this is called raw or not, but whatever the score, whatever points that you got from these all collections of points over here, then you will go against the MUIC evaluation scheme. So that means if you would like to get an A in this class, then you need 90 out of 115, okay? And it's going to fail the class if you have less than 60 out of 115. So that will give some sort of like the scaling pretty close to like a regular scaling, which is about roughly about 50% or so that you're going to fail the course. Sounds like a good plan here? All right, so we already agreed on this. So we should be fine. But anyway, we are going to have the first exam pretty soon, but probably not too soon because you can vote to have the first exam probably somewhere maybe a week or 2 weeks from now, okay? So you can sort of cast your vote in the poll right there, okay? All right, so that's what we going to, just ask you to at the end of today's lecture, and then I'll just post the selections for you to vote in our Google Classroom then, okay? Okay. Oh, I didn't know that, but that's okay. All right, thank you for information. All right, so I have one of your friends telling me about there'll be okay some students that came from the MUIDS that might be absent. That's fine. Okay, so we don't have any attendance in this course, so I think the only thing that might give some impact, if you cannot make it to live session, that's fine. You can catch up using YouTube. Yeah, thank you. All right, got it. All right, guys, so let's dive into today's lecture, and it's going to be a lot of fun. I'll keep saying that every time. And they say a lot of fun. Man, this is something that we are going to give you the connections from what you have already learned. We have learned a lot, actually. We learned about temperature, heat, first law of thermodynamics, processes, and everything that we probably try to calculate. So now we're going to sort of like pull them all together and try to explain something that is closer to our lives, and that is heat engines. Okay, so that's the main focus of us today. And that's going to be the next time we're going to deal with the entropy, and we're going to end this module with the second law of thermodynamics. Okay, but the material that we are going to learn today has some connection to the second law, of course. Okay, so there will be a discussion about what is the difference between the first law and the second law, on and on. All right, so I think you will see a connections throughout, from last time to today and then to the next. Okay, so let's see what I have for you today. So as the name imply, it's a heat engine. So that means it's going to be engines that runs or operated by heat. And then we understand heat is just the energy transfer due to thermal differences, or, you know, something that has some thermal as the course of that changes or flow or exchange or whatever. All right, so we call those heats. So what it means is we're going to have to deal with some hot temperature. Okay, so let me use color coded here, something hot. Okay, so we call and name that hot reservoir. So that will be a source of like a big chunk of energy that at high temperature, and it's going to have somehow very close to somewhere colder, so at lower temperature, that as a T-cold. So we're going to call that cold reservoir. And now everyone knows that, I mean, if you don't have any engine or whatsoever, the flow of the energy will go from hot to cold automatically. We already knew that. And then eventually, if you take these two reservoirs, put them in contact, they're going to try to find equilibrium somewhere, right? Okay, so that means if you have some place that hot, some place that cold, you have a constant flow of energy. In terms of heat, of course. So as human, once we understand that this is energy, so what we want to do is we want to tap into this and then try to steal, that sounds kind of bad, we try to steal part of that energy and try to redirect and to create something useful for us. Does that make sense? Okay, so it will be ideal, it will be best if we can steal them all. So that means, well, okay, then don't let any heat flow to the cold reservoir. Just redirect them 100% toward work. So that means you can pretty much grab energy out of thin air. That's pretty much what it is. All right. So then just redirect and then do something useful, turn the wheel, lift some weight or whatever. And we will learn that this is not possible, of course. Okay, if it's possible, then we don't have any energy crisis or anything right now. So that's what we're trying to get to. Okay, so what it means, what we having in reality is, of course, you're going to have some heat transfer from the hot reservoir. And then we're going to install or, you know, device something that take that energy in. So we're going to name that engine. All right, so we are going to create an engine that take in that heat and hopefully turn some of it into some useful work. But because we are going to have some assumption saying that we cannot do that 100%, so there will be some leftover, okay, that you have to discard or you have to dump out into the whole reservoir. So that means what you have to do is you just have to release, you have to let go of a part of energy, so you can call that Q cold. So is that cool? All right, so this is going to be the main diagram of the heat engine. So the heat engine will take energy from the hot reservoir, try to turn it into something useful. That's the W, that's the work done by the engine. And then the leftover gonna have to be dumped into a cold reservoir. Cool? All right, and because everything has to go through a conservation of energy, you cannot avoid this. Everything has to follow, as long as, I mean, so far we haven't seen anything that violates conservation of energy. So the easy equation that you can get out of this is, of course, the amount of work done is just going to be the difference between the heat flowing in and the heat flowing out. Because we don't want to deal with the confusion about the sign, you can put an absolute sign in there. So you can say, okay, then just take the magnitude of the heat that flow into the engine, and then you subtract the energy that flow out. Whatever the difference is, that must be the work that the engine can perform. Cool? It is that simple. All right. Now you think about it again, Ajahn. Wait a second. So if you want to have this engine run, and then if you want it to run repetitively, I mean, you want to keep it running. So you probably need this engine to perform or to operate something in cycle. Does that make sense? All right. So that seems like, okay.
Okay.
That seems like to be pretty close to something that run in your car engine, right? You have the, you know, the piston and the cylinder and everything just go in cycle. Yeah, that's the whole idea. So that means you want things to run in a cyclic process somehow. And each round or each cycle of that process, you do this one thing, one time. Take in the heat, generate the work, dump out some leftover, okay? And the good thing about having a cyclic process is you know right away that the internal energy will be no change. The delta U is zero because you come back to the original position. So from the first law of thermodynamics, delta U equal to Q minus W. And because delta U is zero, so what you get over here is just the total amount of work that you deal with in this process is going to be exactly the same as the amount of heat that dealing with that cycle. Okay, so that's it. So this whole thing are just related from the first law of thermodynamics. Everything is just conservation of energy. Cool?
Okay.
All right, I think you get the idea. All right, now, what's next? Well, Ajahn, this is okay. All right, it's simple. It's just conservation of energy. So what you want is you want to talk about, and then because we have some assumption that they try to turn some energy that got from the hot reservoir, turn it into something useful, then you probably want to know how efficient is that process. Okay, you want to know like, okay, how efficient this engine is running. So you define something that you can name it like an efficiency. The concept of efficiency is easy. You want an output, of course, from your engine. Okay, that's fine.
Okay.
But then you have to compare that to your input, right? That's a concept of your efficiency. Just like we're studying right now. Like I'm teaching you guys for an hour, how many minutes of material you can understand. Something like that. So it's like I'm teaching you 50 minutes. You might be able to take it into your understanding for 5 minutes or something like that. So that means your efficiency of getting to understand the material is like 5 out of 50. So it's only like 10% efficient. Okay. Well, to speak a little bit fairer, I think it's just like how well I'm teaching. Maybe it's not your. So it's probably like, okay, I'm teaching you guys 50 minutes. Then how much can you understand what I'm teaching? Okay, so maybe it's my part. Okay. Okay, so that's what the concept of the efficiency. It's very simple. So in here, what is output? Of course, it's going to be the work I done. That's what you're expecting from the engine. Okay?
Okay.
And then what is your input? Of course, the input is right here. You have to dump a lot of energy into the engine, okay? So that's why that's your input. So the ratio between the W and the Q hot will give you the efficiency. And because we are talking everything about thermal, right? That's what we have been doing over here. So you can might put an adjective saying that, okay, this is called thermal efficiency. All right, and because we already knew that the work is just a difference between the Q hot and the Q cold, you can manipulate this expression and rewrite it in terms of 1 minus the ratio between Q cold over Q hot.
Okay.
Sounds cool? All right. So that's a whole big idea that I just want to lay down right now. But one thing before we move on, do you notice something here? When will you get efficiency of 1? When will you get efficiency of 0? So look at the efficiency over here. It's going to run between 0 and 1. It's never going to go beyond that or never go below 0. Okay? So if you have efficiency of 1, this means that's 100% efficient engine. If you have efficiency of zero, this means you get nothing out of it. Okay, but if you look at the expression in the last one, the last form of the expression over here, it's kind of nice to see when are you going to get efficiency of one. Where's your perfect engine? Well, you can do that when you reduce this to zero. That's when you get efficiency of one. Or you can do this by taking the Q hot to be infinite. Which is, of course, it's impossible, all right? But at least you get an idea that the bigger the flow in, okay, hopefully that will make your efficiency grow higher in general because it's down here, okay? So you get like the denominator to get super big. And this is part of the reason why your car engine has to combust your fuel to be at super high temperature. Because assuming that once you combust your fuel, let's say it might go up to like 6,000, 5,000, 6,000 Kelvin, and hopefully something that hot must contain a lot of thermal energy. And then you hopefully you can extract some energy out of that and turn the wheel, drive your car on and on. All right, cool. All right, so I hope you get, at least you get to see a little bit now, why do we have to set up to something super hot in your car, because that is going to be your hot reservoir right there. Cool? All right. So, unfortunately, as you can see here, the engines that operating in your car, and just a regular internal combustion car, in the diesel engines, the efficiency is only around, I mean, the best today is probably like 40-something%. Okay? So, pretty much like more than half get thrown away. And this is the reason why your car engine is running super hot. I mean, you cannot touch it easily. It's super hot there. That's because of something that's get discarded out. It's pretty much useless, pretty much, okay? Efficiency is less than half. And no doubt why we are sort of like moving toward the electric vehicle, okay? Hopefully having the motor attached directly to the wheel and then spin everything. And I mean, you know, you already reduce the number of parts in your car tremendously, of course. You don't have any transmission, you don't have any, you don't need that part, this part. Plus, because you use electric, so electricity is your source, so actually you can drive the efficiency of the electric vehicle up to maybe, well, they claim like 90-something%, but to me, I kind of like don't take that to be the real efficiency, because you have to take into account the efficiency in building up the parts as well. Because, you know, to building up a car, you need to build a battery, you have to build that, this and here. So, but of course, if you look at just the utilization of the electricity and turn it into mechanical energy using motor in the EV vehicle, okay, the efficiency will be very high, okay, because motor is a very efficient device. Okay, it can run like 90-something% efficient. So that's very good. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, you're right. Exactly. Correct. So that's why usually the numbers is more like advertisements, I guess, to me. All right. But anyway, it's way better than internal combustion anyway. Okay, because we lose more than half to just, heat the environment pretty much. Okay, guys, so I think this is just the fundamental, and this is something that we just defined it, and we're going to dive deeper into the calculation. But before we do that, let's give it a shot on a simple question here. You have a gas engine that burns 0.2 gram of fuel and delivers 2,000 joules of work per cycle. So each cycle, it takes 0.2 gram, combust it, turn into, you know, some hot gas and everything, released out the energy from chemical reaction and everything. So given that the heat of combustion is 5 × 10⁴ joule per gram, okay, so you can understand this number by looking at the unit. So that means every gram of the fuel burned, you will receive 5 × 10⁴ joule. Simple as that. So that means what you can conclude from here is if you burn 0.2 gram, that will provide you the Q hot. Does that make sense? Okay, you just burn that, bam, you get total amount of, I mean, well, you can call it like ML. The equation look like a Latin heat of phase transition and everything. So you have 0.2 gram times 5 times 10 to the 4th joule per gram. Perfect. All right. So gram units cancel. So you get 10,000 joule each cycle out of this combustion over here. And then now I can map this onto our diagram over here. So this amount of heat from the fuel will run into your engine. And it turns out this engine can deliver 2,000 joules of work. So this work done coming out of this engine, 2,000 joules. From conservation of energy, you know right away, 8,000 must be discarded out here. Cool? That's easy. And what about the efficiency? No problem. Efficiency is what you get over what you have to provide. You are getting 2,000 joules of work. And you are providing 10,000 joules of energy. Okay? So now your efficiency of this one is 0.2. Or you can say is a 20% efficient engine running right now. Okay, cool? All right, that's not too bad, I hope. All right, this is something that's easy to understand. The concept of efficiency is just right here. All right, now, what else that we need over here? We have learned like PV diagram to sort of like understand the process here and there. We already learned, you know, like isothermal process, all this and that. These processes that you have learned in the past can be reversed. Because we said, as long as you can draw PV diagram and you have any sort of like path that running from initial point to the final point, you can actually write the arrow saying that, hey, it's go from left to right in this case, right? But nobody will have any problem if you say about that, I want to reverse the whole process. You just trace everything back. Okay, so everything is reversible. And because we start up study thermodynamics at this point, and it's like a thermodynamics with, okay, I'll talk more about that, all right? That's a key part of today's lecture as well. So what we have over here is everything can be run, can turn it into a reverse process. So that means the diagram that we showed you, that you have seen, you can run everything backward as well. So that means you can have an engine that pull an energy from the cold reservoir. However, to do that, you have to reverse all the arrows. So that means the work, instead of you receive some work from the engine, you have to provide some work to the engine. And hopefully, eventually, you're going to be able to dump some heat out. Okay? Well, you can run everything in reverse. But when you see this one, what do you see? What do you see? Yeah. Yeah. Okay, I don't have the sound effect right now. The screen is locked. I just changed my phone right now, and it's just like it just keep locking. I don't know why. It's just like a few I cannot, I'll find it later. So, what we have over here is a refrigerator, or you can think of it like air conditioner. See, what you're seeing in this diagram is the air conditioner. Yeah, negative work, correct. Because it means instead of you getting some work out of your engine, somehow you have to do things oppositely. You have to provide something to the engine. So this is the air conditioner. Think of it. I am sitting in the room. This room is cold, right? The temperature is lower than outside. The role of your AC, the air conditioner, is to take the energy from inside the room and throw it outside. Does that make sense? So this is exactly what this diagram is trying to tell you. It's drawing some heat from the colder portion of the system and then throw it outside, which is hotter. And the way that you do that is you have to, of course, plug it in. Okay, not plug it in. I mean, you have to provide some work, and that was the hot coil outside at the compressor. They have to sort of like take away all the energy from the inside the room, take it outside, and then release that out by having them condense and everything, turn gaseous system into a liquid again, flow that liquid into this room, pick up some energy, transfer it outside the room, release the energy out, and then sort of like start the whole cycle again and again, all right? Or you can think of this like a refrigerator, same thing. So in the fridge, okay, so inside the fridge is coal, so this is T coal, and then you try to transfer energy outside to the back of the fridge, and that is going to be T hot. So it's the heat engine running in reverse. And everyone knows, Wajan, this is against nature a little bit. This is not natural. So of course not, because think of it like water. Water will fall from high to low. If you want to take water from low to high, what do you use? You use water pump. You have to pump the water from low to high. Same thing over here. Heat flow from hot to cold in general. It's not in general. That's what it is. So heat run from hot to cold. If you want to have the heat flow from cold to hot, you have to pump it up. So that's why we name this heat pump. Does that make sense? All right. But everything is just conservation of energy. So that means you're looking at the Q coal, you're looking at the work done. So what you get is the sum of these two must eventually add it up to Q hot. So nothing has changed. Okay, but one thing that we can add on top of this one is you might be asking, Ajahn, what about the efficiency of this heat pump? All right, so let me call that a little bit. Okay, let me name this efficiency for now. I put a quotation mark here because we have, you know, some adjustment about the naming in a little bit. But the concept stays the same. What you get over what you have to provide. So if you think of this one as a cooling device, so this means you are operating in the cooling mode. You want to cool the room down. You want to cool the inside the fridge. So that means what you want or what you want to obtain from this one is this Q coal right here. Does that make sense? You want the Q coal. This is what you're expecting from the heat pump. And what you have to provide, guys? Well, of course, and you have to provide the work. This is the one that you have to supply to the engine. See? So the concept of efficiency is still here. However, because this ratio might overrun 1, it doesn't have to be 1 anymore. 0 is 0, but I mean, the numbers can go beyond 1, which is kind of weird. Efficiency greater than 1 is kind of, you know, not right. So that's why they changed the name a little bit, and then they try to use the name of coefficients of performance. That's all. Okay, but in the back of your mind, it's just efficiency anyway. Okay, and because we are looking at the cooling operation of the device, so that's why we call this a COP, and you might be able to put like a cooling mode over here. Because I mean, if you turn this heat pump into a heater, so what you are expecting is going to be Q hot, right? Because if you use this heat pump to pump the heat into the room, let's say I'm in like a super cold country, outside is like snowing, super cold, and we want to warm up the house and everything. So you might want to pump the heat from outside to the inside the house. So in that case, the COP for the heating mode is going to be what you're expecting is a Q hot. And then you divide it by the W. Okay, but because we are living in tropical country here, everything is hot and we're using air conditioner all the time. So we're probably not going to try to talk about COP in the heating mode. All right, plus to warm up the room, I think you have other ways that you can do that, right? I mean, yeah, burn some coal or burn some wood or whatever, right? I mean there's so many ways that you can heat things up, or maybe just, I don't know, turn something on that's not very efficient so you can already warm up the room very easily. All right, you might not need the heat pump per se. Okay, but anyway, I hope you understand what it means by having the engine that is operating between two different temperature. All right, and that we call heat engines. Sounds cool? All right then. Okay. Very nice. So now this is the main thing that I want to give you to understand what we are doing over here. Now, you guys, focusing on the left scenario over here, I'm going to ask you a couple of questions here. Guys, you probably saw this maybe once or twice already. The scenario is easy. You have a container, okay, it's insulating. So it means don't worry about the heat. There'll be no heat flow in or out. Okay, that's fine. Now you have gas inside. And let's say initially gas is staying in the bottom of the container, just bottom half of the container is being contained using a membrane. And then let's say the membrane just breaks, and then the gas just, of course, fill up the whole space. Okay? So บอกอาจารย์ because there's no heat we already saw that there's no work because the container cannot expand or shrink or anything so there's no work done so that means there will be no delta U the total internal energy of this gas stays the same and hence the temperature no problem the temperature will not change but everything else can change no problem according to equation of states PV equal to nRT so that means the gas increased two times the volume is twice as big so the pressure will drop in half so no problem Adan this is good but here we go guys it's one way does that make sense it's one way you cannot make this going backward
okay
no you can't even though you might just argue about Dan but there is a chance well Dan that might be possible right that all those gas molecules maybe just you know by accident just gathering at the bottom half of the container well yeah if you want to calculate the probability of that there will be some probability but you will see that that probability will be super super duper low okay plus if you want to wait for that it, you might have to wait longer than the age of the universe something like that all right so we can call that impossible okay so and even it's possible it's not gonna stay there for a long time it's gonna just like okay let's gathering around at the bottom half of the tank and then so what and then just split second everything will just change back to the original crazy fill up the whole space scenario anyway so we can name this process to be irreversible that's fine so what's the point then look at the configuration on the right So now let's say I have that same gas, same volume of gas and everything here in the container. But now this container have a movable piston, just like what we saw before, and it's connected to the energy reservoir at the bottom. So that means you also guarantee that the temperature can be kept constant, just like before. Okay, now what you have over here is I can actually start to compress this gas bit by bit.
Okay.
So by pouring the sand. All right. So first of all, this is your thought experiment, okay? It's not real. All right? It's not. I mean, it could be sort of very close to real, but I think this is more like you imagine this whole experiment in your head. So it's sort of like pouring in sand grain by grain. So it means you can compress the gas slowly, slowly, slowly. And then you just like, okay, I changed my mind. I want the gas to expand back to the original volume. Okay. I'll pick up the sand grain by grain again. And slowly the gas can slowly, and then just increase back to the original position. Cool?
Okay.
So it seems like if you do things in a very, very small step, and then you do it slowly enough, seems like this process is reversible. And this is what we have been doing all along. Using the PV diagram. Because we said, about that, as long as you can draw a line in the PV diagram, and then you can say you start from here, you end there, you put an arrow there, so that's okay, that's expansion, right? But then we can easily say, hey, what if I just want to compress the gas backward? You just flip the arrow and then you say you're done. So that means every process that you can draw on a PV diagram, it's a reversible process. So that means everything that we have learned since the beginning of this lecture and this course over here, we're talking about this kind of process over here. Does that make sense?
Okay.
So we assume the equilibrium, we assume the slowly changing process, we assume that everything that you see from this system can be measured exactly. That's why you can put point in your PV diagram, you can measure the pressure, you can measure the volume, you can measure the temperature, right? So that's why what we're learning over here is called equilibrium thermodynamics.
Okay.
So it's a thermodynamics that you pretty much have to wait for everything to be in equilibrium before you do something else. And that makes perfect sense. Because if you don't wait, in this room, for example, the temperature at one corner might not be the same as the temperature at the other corner if everything in this room is still in sort of like dynamically changing. Does that make sense? So you might have to wait a little bit to make sure that, okay, all the gas in this room are at the same temperature. And then you can say, okay, this room has temperature off, blah, 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 on and on. Okay, so that's why you have to wait a little bit. Okay, but I mean, the change could be pretty quick. And then so you can use the assumption that thermodynamics that we have learned, it's kind of work. Okay, and actually it works. Okay, it's not that bad. It's just not very realistic. But we have to start somewhere, right? So you get a sense of this one, just like what you did with the sigma F equal to ma. Okay, we know sigma F equal to ma is always pretty much like this, correct. But in reality, you have some other effects that you have to take care of, on and on. Same thing over here. Thermodynamics works. Except in reality, there are something else that you have to consider. And what we are looking at right now is the reversibility. That's why this sentence is going to kill ya here.
Okay.
Every process in this world is irreversible process. So just keep in mind, all right? So we're just learning thermodynamics in equilibrium. That's the key point. Okay. And the reversibility will come into play a very, very crucial role. Because look at this. Okay, wait, before we get to that, look at this. What is the first law of thermodynamics? First law of thermodynamics say delta U equal to Q minus W. And when you look at this one, Wajan, it's always true. No problem. Delta U here, Q here, W there. Oh, then 0 equal to 0 equal to 0. So, first law of thermodynamics cannot tell you the direction of the change. Does that make sense? Wow. Right? No. It just only said left-hand side of the equation must be equal to the right-hand side. But that's no direction. There's no left to right or right to left. So that's why you can sort of like start to see that this first law of thermodynamics doesn't help you explaining something about the reversibility of the process. So this is the starting point of the connection to the second law. You need something else to help you identify the direction of a process. But before we get to that, wait for it. All right, we're not getting there just yet. Just for today, we're only gonna care about the reversibility just for the purpose of the heat engine. Okay? So what I am trying to say over here is, all right, now we understand that in reality, most of the stuff that we're talking about are irreversible processes. Okay? But by analyzing the reversibility of a process, we will have an ability, here we go, guys. Wait for it. To look for the best engine in the universe.
Okay.
Isn't that amazing, exciting? No? So what we learned, we about to learn today is, I am going to show you after the break, what kind of engine eventually gonna have the highest efficiency that this universe can give you. Even Thanos won't be able to build an engine better than this. Tony Stark won't be able to do anything better than this. Of course, as long as they use thermal engine, of course.
Okay.
They probably use some other tech, right? Maybe quantum technology or, I don't know, you know, I don't know, some weird deep space multiverse engine or whatever. But anyway, as long as they base the engine on the thermal effects, we are arc reactor. Yeah, maybe arc reactor and stuff like that. Okay, so as long as we're going to use the thermal engine, I'm going to show you after the break, what kind of engine will give you the maximum efficiency. All right? Spoiler. No, not spoiler, okay? Guys, okay, so I think this is a good point to take a break, but at least this will give you an idea of what we about to do after the break. Sounds good? All right, guys, so I think this is a good point to take a break right now, maybe a little bit earlier than 10:50, but I think that's fine. All right, so let's meet back up at like 10:55. Sounds good? All right, and then we'll show you what is the best engine in the universe after this, guys. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, so what we have for you here, it's going to, I don't know what's going to happen to you, but it's just, what I'm saying is, it's going to be some very weird stuff going on. And this is about getting you to understand what is going to be the best engine in the universe. Believe it or not, yeah?
Okay.
All right, so what we have for you here is this. Think about this scenario over here. You have a metal box, okay, at 70 Celsius, and inside this metal box it contains an ice. Okay, there's an ice cube in there. Of course, everyone knows if you sit there and wait a little bit, the ice will eventually completely melt and the metal box will cool down a little bit. All right, you even know how to calculate this using those calorimetry techniques and stuff we learned before. Q hot equal to Q cold. Equate that one. You do the ML and the MC delta T stuff. You can do that kind of thing. But the point that I want to make right here is, hey, this is an irreversible process, yeah?
Okay.
Yeah, make sense? Because everyone knows, like, there's no way that the liquid water will turn into an ice and the metal box will warm itself back up to 70. That's not possible, right? But you guys know that during this process, you have to, I mean, there's a heat involved. There is a heat exchanging between the metal box and the ice. Okay, and because there's a heat involved over here, but it's a one way. So that means whatever the heat that's involved in this change, you cannot bring it back. Mm-mm. Gone. Forever. What are you saying? You see what I'm saying
okay.
here? So it's like, whatever the heat involved in this changing process, you cannot tap into this heat anymore. So what I'm saying over here is, you cannot bring this thing back. The heat cannot be converted anymore. So what I could consider this heat to be like a lost. So this is the lost heat. It's gone. You cannot access this anymore. Okay? But now if you look at a different scenario, let's say that now the metal box stays at 0 degrees Celsius, same temperature as ice. Now think about this one, because of the ice itself composes of like tons of molecules of water, you cannot control all those molecules to be exactly like, hey, stay in solid phase. No, you can't. As long as you are sitting perfectly at 0 degrees Celsius, it could be liquid water, maybe. It could be ice in the solid phase. Doesn't matter. All right. So that means if you're considering the process of melting the ice right on this temperature, 0 degrees Celsius, well, you still be able to think of this one as a reversible process.
Okay.
Does that make sense? When I said reversible means, it doesn't seem to hurt if you want to take this liquid water and turn it back into ice. Because everything is still happening, it's still doable at 0 degrees Celsius. So that means the heat that involved in this process, it's still not completely gone. It's still within this system, and hopefully in the future, you are still able to tap into this and do something good out of this cue. Cool?
Okay.
Get a clue a little bit here? So that means what you have is the heat can still flow back and forth. So hopefully it's still not lost. It's still sort of like available. It's still available. All right. So what's the point about the lost and the availability of these heats? Well, look at the concept of efficiency, guys. The way that you want to increase the efficiency is you want to get a lot of work done out of your device, right? The bigger the W, the better the efficiency, right? But over here, the contribution of this If you have heat that get lost along the way or whatever the process that this engine is running, if the engine keep having building up the lost heat, of course, the less amount of energy that is going to be available for you to create some useful work will getting smaller and smaller as well. So it means the bigger of this dude over here, the lost heat over here, the efficiency will drop. Does that make sense to you? Yeah?
Okay.
On the other hand, you want to keep this available heat as big as possible because that will eventually turn to higher efficiency because you have more chance to be able to create work done out of this. So the point is, because we cannot make 100% efficient engine, so we want to make the best possible. And when you look at these two, what do you notice over here, guys? Do you see something here? All right, here. Don't need this. The thing is, if the temperature has some differences here, 40, 70, 0, you need to change some temperature. And of course, in real heat engine, you need this change. You want to protect your system to have small amounts of Q as possible during this process. And if it's possible, just make it disappear. Cool?
Okay.
To make it disappear means you think of adiabatic process. Make sense? Yeah, big heat over here. On the other hand, well, Bajan, not only the temperature is in the picture over here, you need to transfer heat no matter what. We cannot just keep talking about adiabatic because if you're just using just adiabatic, there will be no heat flow in or out. We need heat to flow in and out. So if you want that heat to flow in and out, just do it at a fixed temperature. Cool? And you're thinking of isothermal process. Isn't that cool, guys? You got that one?
Okay.
So this is gonna be the strategy that we're gonna get into the best heat engine in the universe. It means every time that you want to transfer heat in or out, do it isothermally. Every time that you want to change the temperature, block the heat flow. Do it adiabatically. And if you can build a system, I mean the engine, you can build an engine that combines the isothermal process and adiabatic process, you should get to the best engine in the universe.
Okay.
And that's what we get right here, guys. This engine called Carnot engine. And this engine uses isothermal process to do the heat transfer part of your engine. And they're going to use adiabatic process when they want to do the temperature change in that process. Okay, the Carnot over here, that's the name of French engineer who realized this kind of process. Going to give you the best engine in this universe, guys. Okay? All right, let's take a look. What is going to be the engine under the PV diagram? All right, we're going to combine these two type of processes and build an engine. And here we go, guys. Welcome to the Carnot engine PV diagram right here. First of all, don't forget, this thing is going to run in cycle. So they're going to have a complete loop. So it's going to be a closed loop processes in the PV diagram, of course. But then because we want to combine only just two types of processes, so just take a ride with me here. Start from A, guys. Okay, let's say, because you can draw the diagram next to this one. Don't forget, this is your engine over here. Okay. You want to draw in the heat. You want to draw in the heat. That's the Q hot that we're talking about, right? And we just said, every time that you want to bring in the heat into the engine, you just have to do it at the constant temperature. So remember, every time you look at the PV diagram, please, in the back of your mind, imagine this imaginary isotherm. Okay, that's an isothermal line there. So actually, I can draw another one here. So, and you guys remember, the lower the isotherm, the lower the temperature. So the higher line isotherm, that's a higher temperature automatically. So over here at point A, Now you want to draw in the heat. You do it isothermally. So that means the first process will bring you from point A, and then you just expand the gas, let's say to point B. And during this expansion, you do it in an isothermal process. And during this process, you will be able to draw in the heat. That is your Q hot right there. Isn't that cool? All right.
Okay.
And then, of course, you're going to have to change the temperature because, I mean, heat engine has to run between two temperature at least at the minimum. So that means you're going to have to bring your engine into lower temperature region. That means you have to jump out of the upper isotherm. So that means you're about to change your temperature. So to change the temperature, we are going to do it using adiabatic process. And you guys remember, an adiabatic process, you're going to have a curve that is steeper than the isothermal line. Cool? So that means during that step, all right, I'm going to jump from the higher isotherm to a lower one. I'm going to do it using isothermal process. And that's the second portion over here. No heat exchange. You only want to change the temperature of your heat engine. Cool? All right, now you are down at lower temperature now. You must release, you must discard, you must throw out some heat to the cold reservoir there. So that means there is a heat flow out of your engine. So when you want to exchange heat, you do it isothermally. So during that process, starting at point C, you want to dump some heat out. You do it isothermally, so this means you're going to ride along the isothermal line there. Yeah? All right, cool. And now, once you arrive at point D, you want to shoot back up to point A because you want to complete the cycle. So that means, of course, you have to start sort of take your system up to a higher temperature and then ready to draw in the heat again for the next cycle. So that means you want to change the temperature. You want to do it using adiabatic process, and that you're going to jump back here using adiabatic process. Once you complete this, guys, this is
okay.
Chrono engine, the best engine in the universe, guys. Isn't that amazing? Maybe, no? Well. Isn't that mind-blowing a little bit? Like, okay, it's not that bad. We know how to deal with this. We already learned isothermal process. We already learned adiabatic process. And then we just combine them. We get the best engine in the universe. It's just a boosh. No? Okay, all right, fine. Okay, what is the consequence of this numerically? Or how can we calculate? Or what kind of thing that we can draw from this? Well, Ajahn, we kind of know those stuff. Because whenever you talk about the isothermal process, delta U is zero, Q equal to W, yeah? And then you can use the NRT log V final over V initial to calculate the work done or the heat in that process. So no problem, you know how to deal with that. Plus, in the adiabatic process, you already learned that PV to the gamma stay constant. So, okay, no problem. I will be able to use this PV to the gamma combined with the equation of state and write the relationship between the temperature and volume, blah, blah, blah. That's fine. All right. I used to take about like 15 minutes to solve these four equations in front of you right now, but I'm not going to do it here anymore. Because at the end, this is what you get, guys. A very nice, small, compact conclusion right here. It turns out for this Carnot engine or Carnot cycle, the ratio between the Q cold and Q hot is exactly the ratio of the temperature between the T cold and T hot.
Okay.
Very nice conclusion, very simple conclusion. And this is a very unique characteristic of Carnot engine, guys. That's what I'm asking you to. Well, I don't want to say memorize, but it's just so easy to memorize, so you should be able to do it, right? Okay, well, that's not a good sound effect there. All right, but anyway, that's what it is. So that means you can write down the efficiency of a Carnot engine. So that's why I put the subscript C over there just to say, hey, this is a Carnot engine right there. It's 1 minus Q cold over Q hot. You remember from the definition of efficiency. But now I can turn this ratio into the ratio of the temperature.
Okay.
Cool. That's nice. Okay, so that's the efficiency of Carnot engine. All right, that's a question comes in. So that's why as we approach the closer, that is very good, guys.
Okay.
Exactly right. So this is exactly what I want you to notice over here. When are we going to get 100% efficiency? With the best engine in the universe, you need to take this to be 0 Kelvin. Whoa. And we already said the 0K is an impossible, it's unattainable temperature.
Okay.
So that means no. In this universe, you are not allowed to steal energy from the environment and turn it into a useful work 100%. That doesn't work here. Okay? Plus, just your friend just summarized over there perfectly. Actually, the good thing is the closer that you can get to the 0K, it seems to get a better efficiency easily because you already set up for that. You have the numerator to be super small numbers. So that make your efficiency very high. Okay? So gonna make fortune when heat, death, or... Yeah, you just wait for the heat, death of the universe, all right? But then, I don't know who gonna... I mean, you're gonna make a lot of fortune, but there's nothing else for you to buy anymore, I guess. Yeah? All right, because its universe has already died at that point. So, anyway, so that's another thing that you might be able to think of. Let's say back in the day, you might think of like, John, is there a way that I can use my body temperature that is like about 37 degrees Celsius and the room temperature at about maybe 25, and then we create some device that steal the energy from our body heat and they turn into something useful, maybe like a USB charger, something like that. So, yeah, is it possible? So now you have a theoretical limit. This is an upper limit of a device that you can create. Let's say you want to create something that run between T code of your room temperature. So let's say 25, 27 degrees. So let's say about 300K. And then your body temperature will be your T hot. So your body temperature is like 37. So let's give it like 310. Okay. And from here, you can say your upper limit of the efficiency will be the Carnot engine. So it means if you can build like a mini Carnot engine that runs something and then convert into electricity and then, you know, have a USB output and then you plug it in your device, charge your phone on and on, your efficiency will be limited by this number right here. And you can see efficiency is only going to be like less than, I don't know, it's a single digit percent, yeah, which is pretty small. And now in reality, you have to take into account the frictions, loss due to this, due to that. Nothing is going to be as perfect as Carnot engine. So no, it's not going to be able to have anything left for you to make it useful, right? Let alone we talk only about the efficiency. We don't talk about the capacity. So impossible, right? But now we say, okay, John, your body temperature is kind of like, okay, you're just small body. You're not going to be able to do much. You can imagine that. In the ocean, yeah, you can think of that now is huge. So at room temperature on the surface of the ocean, 25 degrees Celsius, and you say, but then deep down underneath the ocean, the temperature is going to be pretty close to 0 degrees Celsius. So is it possible that we sort of like build like a power plant in between and sort of like steal the heat that flow from the surface, go to the bottom, and then try to run something, generate electricity from here? Okay, now the answer is, well, no, it's not going to be as efficient as you like, because you can see that your difference in temperature is going to be very small. Once again, this is, let's say, approximately 300K. And this is, And this is approximately, like, rough number, 270. Okay, so when you run operating between just 270 and 300K, the efficiency will be like a single digit percent once again. So no, that's why we're not going to see what that kind of power plant running between the surface and the bottom of the ocean temperature difference. No. Cool. All right. So I think up to this point, I hope you see why there are some limitations of the heat engine. And as I said, even Tony Stark or whoever that used, I mean, even Dr. Strange maybe, cannot generate any higher efficient engine than Carnot engine. Okay. All right. Maybe if you use like black magic or whatever, that will be different. All right. But all right. Within the context of thermodynamics, this is the best engine in the universe. Right there, guys.
Okay.
Whoa. All right. So I think, isn't that cool? All right. So just to give you like a quick comparison over there, we already said about the car engine or the stuff. In reality, it might not look exactly like this, but you can approximate the process that's going on in your car engine to be, you know, some PV diagram, you know, you can draw it and then you can calculate the efficiency. But the point that I want to make is you don't have to worry about this diagram over here. I don't want you to worry about the name of the cycle or whatever. But the point is, if you do the full calculation of this cycle and you try to come up with the efficiency, it's going to always be less than the efficiency of the Carnot engine all the time.
Okay.
All right, cool. All right. So that's what's the point of this. I mean, sort of like the introduction of Carnot engine is this is your upper limit of the efficiency that you're going to be able to attain. That's it. Okay. All right. So don't worry about this one. This one, just leave it for mechanical engineer people or, you know, some those stuff that deal with this. But for us, I think we have enough basis to understand how things goes. And I think enough connections between heat engine and the things that we learned from previous weeks in thermodynamics and try to, you know, all right, we understand we can build something out of this one and understand how good or how well or how bad an engine can run, okay, based on first law of thermodynamics there. Okay, so just do like a quick check, guys. If you have three engines operate between reservoirs separated in temperature by 300 K, the reservoir temperatures are the followings. Yeah, so you have 1,700, 800, 500, and 600, and 300. So which one should be the highest possible efficient engine that's running? And now you guys understand that, of course, that is going to be engine C. Does that make sense? Because your T-coil, your low temperature area of the system, is closest to 0K. Okay, so it means the efficiency of the engine C will be bigger than the B, and it's going to be bigger than the A. And one extreme case that I can give it to you is, let's say I have an engine running between 1,000,000 K. It's gonna be harder to, I mean, hard to find in this solar system here, and it's running between that 1,000,000 and 1,300,000. See that? So if you live in that planet or whatever, you will feel that difference of 300 K is like nothing. So this means you're not gonna be able to create any engine that runs efficiently whatsoever, because you're gonna get almost zero efficiency out of any engine running in that planet or on that planet. Does that make sense?
Okay.
All right. So, I mean, the closer that you can get down to 0K, the higher the efficiency you're going to get along with it, based on understanding that your upper limit is Carnot engine. Nice. Okay. Next one, guys. Try this one. You have a Carnot engine that takes 2,000 joules of heat from a reservoir at 500K. All right, you can draw a diagram along with it if you like. You have an engine, okay, and it takes energy of 2,000 joule in. All right, and it's give you the temperature up there. All right, and somehow, of course, it has to discard some heat down here, and it's given to be 350K. They said, find the work done by this engine. All right, because you already knew that this is a Carnot engine, so you know that the ratio between the Q hot and the Q cold is exactly the same as the ratio of the temperature. All right, nice. So with that, it means the Q hot we already identify is going to be 2,000 joule. Over Q cold, this is the one that you're going to want to find out. It's going to be the ratio of the temperature is going to be 500K. Over 350K. All right, and that's it. So you can calculate the amount of heat that you're going to have to discard is what, for 1400 joules right there. Okay, so with that, then you can complete this diagram a little bit here. So it's a 1400 joules, And according to the first law of thermodynamics, or just conservation of energy, you know that the work that you're going to get out of this engine is going to be 600 joules. Okay, and I mean, beyond this one, you can also calculate the efficiency if you like. So the efficiency of this one is going to be work over Q hertz. And it's going to be 600 over 2000. And it's going to be 0.3%. Am I right? Yeah. Okay. Is my number correct here? It's always tough for me to calculate numbers here. All right. Okay. But that's it.
Okay.
That's what it is. Okay. So let's make things a lot, very, very easy to calculate for the Carnot engine because of the simple relationship between the Q hot over Q cold equal to the temperature of the T hot over T cold. All right. Very, very straightforward there. All right. But now here's come the real thing. So if the question asking you this kind of things, everything is going to be simple. All right. Of course not. All right. In reality, the question in the exam is not going to be this easy. Here we go, guys. Let's do a real thing, real question. Okay. So this is going to be the one that actually tests your understanding and combined the stuff that you learned from last week here. And we'll see what is going to happen. Let's dive into it. You have a heat engine operate using the cycle shown. All right, now you are given a PV diagram and everything. The working substance is 2 moles. Cool. So you just say that's your small n right there. Of helium gas, so we're going to assume that that's a monatomic ideal gas there, which reaches the maximum temperature of 327 degrees Celsius. That's kind of nice because you can turn this into Kelvin. So you add 273 to it. So it's going to be 600K right here. All right. Now assume that helium can be treated. Of course, we don't have anything else to treat. And the process B to C is an isothermal process. Cool. All right. So BC is isothermal. So once again, I just want to highlight this part right here that, hey, it's on an isotherm here. And you can also imagine that point A probably lying on another lower lying isotherm right there. Right? This isotherm shouldn't cut XY axis, of course. Okay. I try to draw it nicely here. Right, here we go. All right, something like that. Okay. All right. So now, pressure at states A and C are given to be 10 to the fifth. Cool. All right. So just draw that information there. Yeah. So you know that at the bottom here, the pressure is 10 to the fifth. All right. And the pressure at B is 3 times 10 to the fifth. Everything is in Pascal. All right. Nice. All right, guys. Give it a shot. Part A. How much heat enters and leaves the gas each cycle? Woo. Come on, guys. Don't need that. All right, guys. So, how can we do that? See? So, this is a real stuff. You have to calculate the heat by yourself. And you have to identify which one is going to be the Q hot, which one is going to be the Q cold, blah, 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 on and on. That's what is your task right there. You have to do it. So, let's deal with this each segment at a time. So let's start from A to B, shall we? Yeah, all right, A to B. All right, guys, A to B, you can see that it's a constant volume process. And we have already learned about this. If you want to heat during this process, so let me name this like QAB. It's going to be NC sub V delta T. Remember this one, yeah? Yeah, cool. All right, it's a constant volume molar specific heat. And you can turn this into an equation. If you remember, this one is 3/2 nR delta T. Nice. Okay.
Okay.
And then all you need to do is just plug them in. And it's so easy to calculate now, as long as you know the change of the temperature. Or, if you want to have the turn nRT into PV, that's fine too. So you need some information about the gas a little bit. Okay. However, you already learned from the information given over here that the upper isotherm, that is your 600K isotherm. My question is, do you know the temperature at point A? What do you think? Well, Adan, that's easy. Because if you want to compare between point A and point B, okay, it's a constant volume process. So, about Adan, it's like P A V A over T A equal to P B V B over T B, right? Okay. And, of course, because you say that they are constant volume, so volume cancel, of course, no problem. And then, because you see that the pressure is three times at B, so the temperature must be three times as well. All right, so that's me, no problem, Adan. So that means the lower lying isotherm is gonna be at 200K. Cool? See, not bad.
Okay.
You just do whatever you do with your gas using equation of states, just like what you did before. Just extract the information out. So with that, then you will be able to write down, it's gonna be 3/2, N is equal to 2, R is equal to R. Just leave it as R, don't wanna substitute the number in there. And then you put the temperature over here. Don't forget, stick with the final minus initial. Every time that we have the change, always final minus initial. So it means it's going to be T at B minus T at A, final minus initial, correct? All right. And then, so what I can do over here is 2 cancel, bam, bam. And TB minus TA is going to be 400 Kelvin. So it's going to be 1200 R. Okay, so let me write this one down. This is positive 400 Kelvin, and you are pretty much done over here.
Okay.
From A to B, and as you can see, the sign is automatic because we sort of like straight with the delta means final minus initial. So this one is positive heat. So it's mean going from A to B, you have a positive heat flow of 1200 R. So that means during this process, you have an inflow of heat, QAB. Isn't that nice? The sign is kind of good, all right? And because you are dealing with the closed cycle PV diagram, the closed cycle process, I can draw the direction of the arrow saying that if it's get inside the enclosed area, that means heat flow into the system. That's kind of nice, all right? The interpretation seems to be coincide really well with what you intuitively get from the diagram. Okay, try again, guys. Let's go for BC, shall we? Do you remember how? Yeah? Yeah?
Okay.
QBC from B to C now is an isothermal process. And just to remind you, isothermal process, delta U is zero. When delta U is zero, then you get Q equal to W. But the W is area under the curve, and we have already gone through this using some calculus. We had fun a little bit there. NRT log of V final minus V initial. Remember that one, yeah?
Okay.
All right. So that means during the process B to C, the heat flow from B to C can be calculated from NRT log of V final minus V initial. Isn't that cool? All right. And then just plug in that value that you know. N is 2. R, just leave it as R. Temperature at B or at C is already fixed at 600K. So no problem. Let me put 600 right here. And now log V final is a V at C. V initial is a V at B. Can you figure that out ratio here? Well, Adan, that's no problem. Why? Because once again, P B B B over T B equal to P C V C over T C, yeah? And because these two points are lying at the same temperature, so these two is gone, so the product between the pressure and the volume must stay constant. Because from B to C, you drop your pressure three times. So that means going from B to C, you have to expand your volume three times as well. Okay? No, that's wrong one. Okay, it's supposed to be okay. So that means the ratio over here is supposed to be 3. Cool?
Okay.
Nice. And that's it, guys. So that means This process from B to C will give you, how much is that? 1200 log 3R. And it's positive. Yeah, it's automatically positive. So when it's positive means there is a heat flow into your system. Once again, there you go. QBC. Nice. You start to see okay. What's supposed to be done. Okay. For the rest of this one, yeah, there's one more step to do. Let's complete that one. Now move on to C back to A. Almost done, guys. So when you look at C back to A, it's a constant pressure process, isobaric process. So you can say that QCA is, well, we already learned this one from NC sub P delta T. Cool? Yeah?
Okay.
And with that, then all you have to do is just plug in the value one more time. It's 5/2 for the constant pressure molar specific heats. There you go. All right, substitute value that you have already known. N is 2, R, just leave it there. Now the temperature change, you're going from C to A. So we have to take the A subtracting by the C. Cool? So what you have to do over here is going to be T sub A minus T sub C. And this number right here now is negative because you're coming from a higher lying isotherm to a lower lying isotherm. So you reduce your temperature from 600K down to 200K. So that is a negative 400 over here. Cool. So the sign has already been taken care of. So it's going to be 2 cancel over there. So it's negative 2000 R. The negative sign means heat is leaving the system. So I can now draw an arrow pointing outward over here. And that is going to be QCA. And you are done.
Okay.
Not bad, see? All right, so it looks more complicated in the sense that it's just a little bit lengthy to complete this whole calculations. But in terms of the complexity, it's not bad. It's very doable, okay? But you just have to take like, you know, one segment at a time and try to pull whatever you have learned from last week and then try to utilize it here. Okay, so part A is good. Now, you can answer part B easily now. How much work does the engine do each cycle and what is its efficiency? So I hope just by looking at this, you will be able to answer this one very easily. But I just want to make things clear over here. So let me conclude. This is what you have. You have QAB coming in. Yes. You have QBC coming in. Yes. You have QCA going out. Yes.
Okay.
You should be able to imagine this to be exactly matched your diagram of a heat engine. See this? So there must be a heat flow in, you call this Q hot. And you have a heat flowing out, you call this Q cold. The leftover or the difference must be representing the work done by the engine, right? And just to be perfectly in line between these two diagrams over here, you guys already knew as well, if you are able to calculate the area enclosed by this closed cycle, it will be the W as well. So you see the similarity between these two now? Bojan, that's not bad. I can tell you right now what should be the W. But the W is supposed to be Q hot minus Q cold. But now your Q hot is supposed to be whatever that flow in. So it's going to be QAB plus QBC. Let me put absolute in there. We just care about the magnitude. We know the direction already. Cool? And for the Q cold is the one that you get to discard out from your system. And that will be QCA. Does that make sense? All right. So let me put the absolute in all of these so we don't have to worry about the sign. And that's it, guys. So the W, the work done by this engine is going to be, just take QAB that you got plus the QBC, yeah? And then you just subtract this with your Q from the CA segment. And you are done.
Okay.
And if you want efficiency, Mojan, no problem. Efficiency, now, I mean, the information is already in front of you. You can calculate from the work W, and then you divide it by the Q hots. And you are pretty much just substitute whatever you found here. W is right here. And Q hot just right there. And you are done as well for that.
Okay.
All right, so I hope you see the connections between looking at the PV diagram, do the calculations using everything that you have learned from how to calculate the heat, calculate the work, calculate the potential, the change of the internal energy, everything that you have learned before. Use those to pretty much write down all the information in terms of thermodynamics variables for each segment. And once you have those, things that happens in the PV diagram supposed to be able to map out into the diagram that's showing how the engine operate between hot and cold reservoir. Cool? Not bad, yeah?
Okay.
It's kind of fun, yeah? Somehow. maybe not. All right. Don't go too far then. Okay. So what we have over here is, now that's your answer for part B. So part B is pretty much done right there. You know everything. Now, what about part C? Hey, let's compare this engine's efficiency. So this means this is, you're going to get some number over here, right? So some number right there. Compare these numbers to the maximum possible efficiency attainable with the hot and cold reservoir used by this cycle. So what are we talking about here, guys? Yeah, we're talking about the efficiency of a Carnot engine. So this means, instead of using this cycle, you're going to replace this cycle, or that means you replace the engine that's operating right now, with a Carnot engine that operating between 600K and 200K, okay?
Okay.
And that's it. We already knew how to calculate the efficiency of a Carnot engine. It's going to be T cold over T hot. And you just said, we already knew the coldest temperature of this one is 200K. The highest temperature is 600K. So that means your best engine that can operate, which is Carnot engine, is going to have the efficiency of 2/3. So it's mean about 66.67% efficiency running between this one. And you will see this number will definitely be bigger. So it means whatever the number that you got in the box up here will be less than 66.67% all the time. Okay?
Okay.
Isn't that nice and beautiful here? And this is how thermodynamics give you, well, sort of like talk about the conservation of energy one more time, plus give you a clue of what's supposed to happen next, because you already get to the point where, hey, I know what is the best engine that can operate, plus there is, I mean, sort of like the way that you can get to this, talking a little bit about the reversibility of process. So next time, we're going to take that reversibility stuff and spring to another subject. Well, it's the same subject, sorry. And spring to another topic about the second law of thermodynamics, that's talking about the direction of a process. Sounds cool? I think so. Yeah. All right. So if this is good, I think this is a good point to stop right here, guys.
Okay.
All right. In terms of the material that I want to present to you today. And we're going to have the rest for you, which is, all right, this is a bigger exercise. And I think this is a good place that we're supposed to work through this one together one more time, but just save it for next time. All right. So we're going to use this exercise as a review problems for everything that we have learned one more time at the starting point of next lecture. Sounds cool? All right then. So
okay.
That is it for today, guys. All right.